يتدبرون القرآن
ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم The Quran, the book of Allah, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala important for each and every one of us to recite it, to ponder over it and to act according to it This is what the duty on every Muslim to do with the book of Allah, the final revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to mankind and to also the non-Muslims, to every single human being on the face of earth to get to know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us to read and to find out for their own selves that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the Most High the Most Gracious subhanahu wa ta'ala He created us for one purpose and that is to worship Him alone and to follow the messengers of Allah And with the revelation from Allah, the human being would get to know how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To do what is good and to avoid what is evil. To get to know what is good and what is evil. To get to know the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth. How the struggle between the truth and falsehood. And the people, those who carry the truth versus those who carry falsehood. And how the struggle is something that is the nature of this life. For people to be tested. For people to be rewarded and to be punished. For the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be there in the day of judgment. And for the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be bestowed upon the believers. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who are steadfast among the believers. And to make us benefit from the Quran to change our life according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. We reached Surat Al-Imran verse number 181. Take from 181 to 185. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks in these verses and most of them, continuing the subject of the surah about in the beginning, about the people of the book, and then the Jews and the Christians, and then the battle of Uhud and some of the lessons to be learned. And the last thing, which is in verse number 180, it's about those who are greedy, those who withhold what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon them and do not extend their benefits to other those who are greedy, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned them. And continuing the warning to Bani Israel, as we would hear in this verse 181. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم لقد سمع الله قول الذين قالوا إن الله فقير ونحن أغنياء سنكتب ما قالوا وقتلهم الأنبياء بغير حق ونقول ذوقوا عذاب الحريق Which means Allah has certainly heard the statement of those who said Indeed Allah is poor which we are rich While we are rich we will record what they said and their killing of the prophets without right and will say Taste the punishment of the burning fire This ayah, or this verse says, لَقَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala heard, certainly heard the statement of those who said what they said. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the all-hearer. And He subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is one of His attributes. And there's an implication to this in our life. First, it's a matter of belief. We believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears, but nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِي شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ Nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and He's the all-hearer, the all-seer. We as human beings, we hear. Animals, they hear. But of course, how the hearing is, it's not something that we know about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is unseen to us. And the reason why we mention this is because when sometimes some people, they read this, They recite this out of the respect, out of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they might fall into distorting the meaning or even denying it completely, saying, no, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not hear because this is an attribute to the human beings. And how can we resemble Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make him like the human beings, like the creation of Allah, which is of course an act of kufr. The reason they would say that is they would make their minds go further beyond what they're supposed to. They would fall into the tashbih or the resemblance in which this is not permissible. They shouldn't. They should just believe in it the way it is, understand the meaning of it, because this is clear Arabic word that means one thing, which is hearing, and they should believe in it. But when it comes to how, then this is not something that we have the knowledge of. This is unseen to us. So we always repeat the verse in the Quran, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِي شَيْءٌ وَالسَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. Nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He's the all-hearer, the all-seer. So what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say here? لَقَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala certainly heard the statement. And anything that is heard by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So people need to be watchful of what they say. A word, as the Prophet ﷺ said, a word that a person would say without thinking too much of what is being said can take the person deep into the hellfire for 70 years. إن العبد لا يتكلم بالكلمة لا يلقي لها بالا. That he would say a word, utter a word that doesn't give too much attention to, يهوي بها في نار جهنم 70 خريفا. That he would fall, take him down into the hellfire for 70 years, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the all-hearer. This is something that has to be shown in our acts of worship, that we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based on the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of which that He's the all-hearer. So we should not say anything that we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade us from saying. We should only say the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with us. Hearing what we say, reciting the Quran, enjoining good, forbidding evil, talking with what is permissible, and to avoid anything that is not permissible. So these people, and the verse refers to Bani Israel, the children of Israel, the Jews, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He certainly heard their statement when they said, الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ فَقِيرٌ وَنَحْنُ أَغْنِيَ. That they said, indeed Allah is faqir, is in need, is poor. وَنَحْنُ أَغْنِيَ, while we are rich. How evil that statement is. Such an evil statement that it makes the believer sometimes difficult to say, but this is the Quran. And we have to recite the Quran. And when you quote something from someone, even if it's kufr, you're not committing the kufr. You're not committing the disbelief. You're just quoting what people would say matters of disbelief, which is mentioned in the Quran in many places. Right? So, of course, this is something that the statement is so evil, and how can a person say that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most rich? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of all things, and He's the owner of all the treasures and the wealth and everything that people have and people do not have, the heavens and the earth and whatever it contains, all belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So who would ever dare to say such a thing, as the book of the Tafsir and the book of Sir would mention, that at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, one of the people of Bani Israel, one of the Jews in Medina, his name is Finhas, he said that. He said that when the verse in the Quran in Surat Al-Baqarah, verse number 245, that talked about من ذا الذي يقرض الله قرضا حسنا فيضاعفه له أضعافا كثيرة. Who would give Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a goodly loan? To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when they read this literally, of course it doesn't mean that a human being would give Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most high, the most rich alone. It means, of course, in the context of the verse, that when a person gives as a charity, gives charity to another human being for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this charity, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts it from the person, then the reward will be given in so much multiplications, not equal to what the person gave, because Allah is the owner, and that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-jawad, the most generous subhanahu wa ta'ala. He asks people to give charity, not that it would benefit Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's no benefit will happen to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Instead, the human being are benefit from this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bestow His favor, the rewards, to those who would give for the sake of Allah great rewards that nobody can imagine. So they took this out of context and they ridiculed basically the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it doesn't mean what they said. So He said that your Lord is asking for a loan. Hasha wa kalla, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala curse those who would say such a thing. That He said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ فَقِيرٌ وَنَحْنُ أَغْنِيَاءِ. He said that Allah is poor while we are rich. And again, how evil that statement is when the human being, they cannot even bring any goodness to them, their own selves. They cannot fight a small virus that they can see with their own eyes. How can they say such a statement? And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سَنَكْتُبُ مَا قَالُوا. We would write, record what they said. That means for the hereafter, for them to be punished in the day of judgment. See someone saying something like this and still live on the face of earth, they might think that this is, nothing will happen to them, they won't be punished, right? And this is something that we mentioned before about the misconceptions of many people on the face of earth, mainly the disbelievers, when they think that when Allah give them time, when they still commit sins and corruption and so on, and they're given time and they don't see themselves being punished on the face of earth, they think that they are on the winning side or nothing will happen to them. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed us that in the day of judgment, the full justice will be served and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the believers. And in this life, the worst punishment is when the person is deprived from repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the heart is sealed and doesn't see the truth, when the person is deviated as a result of their own actions. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سَنَكْتُبُ مَقَالُ. We will record what they have said of this evil statement. And وَقَتْلَهُمُ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍّ. And also will be recorded their killing to the prophets without the right to do that. And this is some of their crimes that they did, as it's mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah and others. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would send them many prophets at the same time and they would kill them. And those who came later at the time of the Prophet ﷺ and those who afterwards, they approved what their ancestors did. So as a result of that, they would receive the same punishment. As we said, which is mentioned in the Quran, one of the facts is that if somebody believe and approve of a false thing that never happened, like the crucifixion of Isa alayhi salam, the crucifixion of Jesus, the son of Mary. That is false, it never happened. The Quran explained that clearly. وَمَا قَتَلُوهُ وَمَا صَلَبُوهُ وَلَكِنْ شُبِّهَ لَهُمْ. He was never killed, he was never crucified. It was only made for them to seem that way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lifted Isa alayhi salam, Jesus, the son of Mary, but he was not crucified. So those who claim that they killed him, and those who followed them, and they would be proud of their ancestors, those who killed or they claimed that they killed Isa alayhi salam, they would come in the day of judgment, as the ulama, they say in the explanation of the verses, they would come in the day of judgment with the sin of killing a prophet of Allah like Isa alayhi salam, Jesus the son of Mary, when he was not even killed. Why? Because of their intentions, because of their liking. They are proud of such a thing. So later generations, they have to be careful with what their ancestors did, and they have to distance themselves, and they have to free themselves from what their ancestors did of crimes and so on. Otherwise, they can share with them these evil crimes. So the verse is talking about those who are present at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, those who would come after them, even though they might not have done the same crime, although they tried to kill the Prophet والسلام, and they put the poison for the Prophet. So one of their crimes, وَقَتْلَهُمُ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍّ, by killing the Prophets without the right to do that, and of course there's no right whatsoever. And the Prophets are the best of all the human beings. And imagine someone, of course killing is killing, but killing the best of all human beings, those who are sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to convey the message, what a worse crime than this. ونقول ذوقوا عذاب الحريق. This will be recorded for the justice to be served in the day of judgment, and the severe and the everlasting punishment in the hellfire for them, those who disbelieved by saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is poor while they are rich, and those who would kill prophets. وَنَقُولُ ذُوقُوا عَذَابَ الْحَرِيقِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and we will say to them, ذُوقُوا, taste. عَذَابَ الْحَرِيقِ, the punishment of the blazing fire. Taste it. That means the fire will have a taste to it. They are living in it. They're drinking from its hot boiling water. They are living in the fire. Their clothes and everything is from fire. Extreme. Nobody can ever imagine the punishment in the Day of Judgment, and they would stay there forever. Everlasting stay. Such a severe punishment for a crime they could have avoided on the face of earth by repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. That's why the next verse, 182, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ذَلِكَ بِمَا قَدَّمَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَيْسَ بِظَلَّامٍ لِلْعَبِيدٍ, which means, that is for what your hands have put forth. And because Allah is not ever unjust to His servants, that this is by what your hands have earned. ذَلِكَ بِمَا قَدَّمَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ. The severe punishment, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, it's because of what you did, because of what your hands earned. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. They could have avoided it, but because of the envy, because of the kibr, because of the arrogance, because of the forgetfulness, because of the disbelief, they committed such an evil crime. ذَلِكَ بِمَا قَدَّمَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ. And human beings, they know that. They see that with their nature, that when somebody commits a crime and they are being punished justly according to their crime, nobody would ever say that this is something wrong. Everybody likes justice. And this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us. So they would come in the Day of Judgment with such an evil crime because of what they earned. وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَيْسَ بِظَلَّامٍ لِلْعَبِيدِ. And indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَيْسَ, He is not. بِظَلَّامٍ لِلْعَبِيدِ, He is not someone that would commit injustice or ever unjust to His servants. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. He's the creator of the heavens and the earth. How can then people attribute any forms of injustice to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? People not necessarily saying that with their tongues. Sometimes they say it with indirect way, when they say, how can a person be punished an everlasting punishment for something that a person committed in this life that is doesn't take too long of a time to take or to make, when life is too short? When a person is a disbeliever for 80 years or 60 years, why would be the punishment not 80 years or 60 years? The question by itself, right, this is a sign of a person not understanding the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is the most just. Even if a person doesn't comprehend something, we have to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being the most just, but the matter is so easy. They have been warned that this is the punishment. So there's no injustice here. And that's why no one, that the message didn't reach them, they will be punished. If the message didn't reach someone, they won't be punished in the Day of Judgment. They will have a test in the Day of Judgment. But if the message reached that this is going to be the punishment for them, that this is justice. And also, their intentions were to be, if they would live on the face of earth forever, they would continue to be disbelievers forever. So the punishment is because of the deeds in their hearts, an everlasting sin. So that as a result of that, an everlasting punishment. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from the hellfire and to make it clear to us matters of truth versus falsehood. We continue, inshallah ta'ala, with more of these verses in Surah Al-Imran right after the break. So stay with us, inshallah.
أفلا
lillah, wa salatu wa salam wa rasulillah. Still with the verses in Surat Al-Imran from 181 to 185 about Bani Israel, the children of Israel, those who had the evil claim and the evil statement, as we heard, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is warning them that everything is recorded. And it's the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it comes to the punishment in the hereafter. That's why we need to get some benefits from these verses, that everything is recorded, and our speech and actions, and any word we say, there are angels recording that on us, whether it's going to be on our side for our favor or against us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. So we have to be watchful with what we say. See, the verse didn't mention the Jews or Bani Israel specifically. Didn't mention the specific person, although it's known from the context. Why? Because what is very important for the reciter of the Quran is the evil act itself, more than just who did it. Because this can be done again, over and over again. Some people, they can say that nowadays. Some people can say evil things about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, claiming evil things about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the same punishment can happen to them. As the ayah clearly says, that everything will be recorded, and they will be said to them, taste the blazing fire, the punishment of the blazing fire. So we need to protect our tongues from saying anything that is bad or evil, even if it's joking, making fun of things, ridiculing things in the religion of Allah. This is as if someone is ridiculing the creator of the heavens and the earth. Because the religion of Allah is the words of Allah, the orders of Allah. So how can a person ridicule something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most High, ordered? When people ridicule hijab, for example, or anything that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered, even if they think that it's something small, the beard, for example, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to the people, ordered the people to do such a thing. So how can a person ridicule this? Even the siwak, as the ulama, they say. If the Prophet ﷺ ordered his ummah to use the siwak before every wudu and before every salah, this is part of the deen. So if somebody would make fun of anything, even if it's they think it's a small sunnah or so, this is an act of kufr, an act of disbelief. So the words that comes from one's mouth is something that is very important for us to watch what we say. And we should not say, I don't mean this or mean that. It doesn't matter whether a person means one thing or the other. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us with having sound minds to be able to think and make decisions before we speak. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala won't punish someone that is insane, for example. But someone has the intellect and the ability to know what is right and what is wrong, then we have to be watchful. Lying, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said in the authentic hadith, وَيْلُلَّهِ 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 لِمَنْ كَذَبَ لِيُضْحِكِ النَّاسِ. Woe to him, three times, for the one that lie to make people laugh. Lie to make people laugh, jokes and so on and so forth. Sometimes it entitles ridiculing people, ridiculing a certain race, ridiculing a certain people in a certain nationality, with a certain nationality. Sometimes even these evil jokes, they ridicule or make fun of the creator of the heavens and the earth, or prophets of Allah. And you would find that in so many of the stand-up comedies and things like this, they would make sometimes refer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the messengers of Allah. This is so evil. So the matter should not be taken lightly. This is something that is so important because we are created to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And again, as we heard in verse number 182, this is what your hands have earned. This is your actions. And it's a benefit from this that if a person didn't earn his actions, was not responsible for a certain act, he's not going to be held accountable for. If a person loses his mind or a person is under the age of being responsible or deaf, did not get to know the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the message didn't reach him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. So it's only for those the message reached them and they understand exactly what it means and they did the actions while knowing that this is wrong, then this is what a person should expect then, unless a person repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also, continuing with some of their crimes and warning them and calling them to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Verse number 183, الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَهِدَ إِلَيْنَا أَلَّا نُؤْمِنَ لِرَسُولٍ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَنَا بِقُرْبَانٍ تَأْكُلُهُ النَّارِ قُلْ قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رُسُلٌ مِّن قَبْلِي بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَبِالَّذِي قُلْتُمْ فَلِمَ قَتَلْتُمُوهُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Which means, they are those who said, indeed, Allah has taken our promise not to believe any messenger until he brings us an offering which fire from the heaven will consume. Say, there have already come to you messengers before me with clear proofs, and even that of which you speak. So why did you kill them if you should be truthful? الَّذِينَ قَالُوا, those who said, again referring to the evil statements of those who said that from the children of Israel at the time of the Prophet ﷺ or before, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَهِدَ إِلَيْنَا, that they claim or they said that Allah had taken the covenant from us, taken our promise and the covenant from us, أَلَّا نُؤْمِنَ لِرَسُولٍ, that we shall never believe in a messenger, حَتَّى يَأْتِيَنَا, till he bring to us, بِقُرْبَانٍ تَأْكُلُهُ النَّارِ, till he bring for us an offering which fire will consume. Qurban is something that is an offering, something that is given in charity or a booty of the war, which is used to be the case for Bani Israel. The booties of the war that they would get, they would collect it together and they would wait for a fire to come from the heavens to consume it. And the Prophet ﷺ, he said that it was made permissible for him and his ummah, the booty of the war. Before, it was not permissible for them. They would collect the booty of the war and the fire would come from the heavens and consume it. Or any qurban, any offering, any good deeds of charity or given, that the fire will come and consume, as it used to be before for Bani Israel. So they claimed that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the covenant from them that they won't believe in any messenger unless this has happened. And this is a lie because it never happened. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never revealed that and they can never prove such a thing. So they claim or they lie against the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is one of the worst, but it's the worst crime actually on the face of earth, when someone would speak about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without knowledge. And this is mentioned in the Quran more than one place, and that's the origin of shirk, associating partners with Allah, the origin of innovation in matters of the deen, when people would speak about Allah without knowledge, and comes from that also speaking about the deen of Allah without knowledge. The deen of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is his deen. This is the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how can a person claim that this is halal or claim that this is haram without any knowledge, without referring the matter back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? So when they claimed such a thing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رُسُلٌ مِّن قَبْلِي, that rusul, messengers, قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ, they came to you, مِّن قَبْلِي, from before me, before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ, with the clear proof and evidences with regards to their messengership, with regards to their truthfulness. وَبِالَّذِي قُلْتُمْ, and by what you asked for, the fire from the heavens to take the booty of the war and so on. فَلِمَ قَتَلْتُمُوهُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ, so why then you killed them if you are truthful, when they approve of what their ancestors did, so they have a share of this crime, so why did they kill them then? If they were waiting for such a claim or such a thing that they asked for, and as we heard in Surah Al-Baqarah and others, that they asked many things from their messengers, and everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would bestow on the messenger and would make it clear to them and show them the miracle that they asked for, and still they denied, still they disbelieved, and still they killed the messengers. So if they were truthful, why would they ask then? So this is something that happens before, and they never accepted it, they never submitted themselves as a result of that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with clear evidences in the book of Allah and the way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and miracles that people saw with their own eyes. but an everlasting miracle, a miracle that will stay with people for each generation to see with their own eyes, and that is the Quran. Then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in 184, فَإِن كَذَّبُوكَ فَقَدْ كُذِّبَ رُسُلٌ مِّن قَبْلِكَ جَاءُوا بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَالزُّبْرِ وَالْكِتَابِ الْمُنِيرِ, which means, then if they deny you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so were messengers denied before you, who brought clear proofs and written ordinance and the enlightening scripture. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is comforting the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that when they denied his messengership, this is not a new thing. This is something that people have been falling into the same evil act. They would deny the messengers of Allah, disbelieving in them. When the messengers of Allah did not ask them for any money, did not ask them for any personal glory or personal benefit, they did not ask them for kingdomship, or they did not ask them for money, for anything. This can make the person maybe have doubts. Maybe they are seeking some worldly gain. But the messengers of Allah, they only asked them for one thing, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to be righteous people. So they should have submit themselves to the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the messengers of Allah. And also a lesson for the followers of the messengers, those who call others to the deen of Allah, they should not ask for their money or their wealth or their status and so on and so forth, but instead they do that sincerely for the sake of Allah, seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. So if they deny you, O Messenger of Allah, if the Jews at the time of the Prophet and the children of Israel, they deny you, in which many of them, they embrace Islam, like some of them, the leaders even, like Abdullah ibn Salam, after seeing the truth, when they had the characteristics of the Prophet ﷺ in their books, it was clearly mentioned in their books, so they were waiting for the Prophet ﷺ, as in the story of Salman al-Farisi radiallahu anhu, which we mentioned it before. They were waiting for the Prophet ﷺ. That's why they came and they resided in Al-Madinah, waiting for the send of the Prophet ﷺ as a messenger. So if they denied the Prophet ﷺ, فَقَدْ كُذِّبَ رُسُلٌ مِّن قَبْلِكَ, indeed, messengers before, they have been denied also. They killed messengers, so they won't deny them. They would say that they are liars and sorcerers and so on. فَقَدْ كُذِّبَ رُسُلٌ مِّن قَبْلِكَ. And we would say usually those who are in state of luxury, in state of forgetfulness, and kibr or arrogance prevent the person from submitting oneself to the truth. They wanted to continue to follow their desires. They don't want to someone to tell them what to do and to have this submission to other than own desires, their own desires. When they believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of all things. So if they deny you, O Messenger of Allah, then a means of comfort that this is not something new. Messengers before, they have been denied. جَاءُوا بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ, they came بالبينات, with the clear evidences and proof, was zubur, and the written ordinance, revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, والكتاب المنير, and the enlightening scripture. They are given like the Psalms of Dawood, David, and the books, the Torah, and the Injil, and the final revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran. So they were aided with scripture, with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and still people denied them and claiming that they are liars and so on and so forth, which is the miserable state of the human being. فَإِن كَذَّبُوكَ فَقَدْ كُذِّبَ رُسُلٌ مِّن قَبْلِكَ, and this is one of the means to seek comfort. If a believer finds himself a stranger, there's not too many help and too much or too many support from others, that the disbelievers, they outnumber the believers, they ridicule the believers, they deny them, they say that they are liars and so on and so forth, they should remember that this is the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth. They should remember that those who before them or other places and other people, individuals, they followed the same truth with them. That would give strength. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran to his Prophet, محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم واصبر نفسك مع الذين يدعون ربهم بالغداة والعشي يريدون وجهه. Be patient, make yourself patient to be in the company of those who call unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the morning and in the evening. It's very important for one's iman, for one's faith to be strong, and to increase our iman is for the person to have the company of those who are like him. Otherwise a person can be deviated, diverted from the truth. And that's why also for our children, for our families, for ourselves, to always have the right companionship, to have those who remind us of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because one of the ways to comfort oneself, if the believers are outnumbered, or the more the person follows the way the Prophet ﷺ, the more that he would find or she would find themselves strangers among the people, among even Muslims. That's why we have to know the truth. It's not something that we, to be a stranger is a goal in itself. No, the goal is to fulfill the deen of Allah. Not according to what is in our environment necessarily, but according to the truth, according to the Quran, and the way the Prophet ﷺ, the way this religion was established and understood at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, the time of the companions of the Allah anhum, not something that people would invent or make up later afterwards. So this is to comfort the Prophet ﷺ, and also we should seek comfort in this, and to understand that the reality of the straight path, that you might not find most of the people on it. You would find most of the people not on the straight path. So that would keep the person steadfast. When tuta akthara min fil ard yudilluka an sabilillah, if you obey most of the people on earth, they would divert you from the straight path. Many people, their following or their actions depends on how people are. If people are doing one thing, they do with them. If people are not doing one thing, they would stay away from also something that they know that this is the truth. The believers, they need to have the courage and the patience and seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do what is right regardless of whether people are doing it or not. We continue inshallah ta'ala with the last verse, 185 from Surat Al-Imran, last verse in this episode, of course, in the segment, right after the break, so stay with us inshallah.
يتدبرون القرآن
Welcome to Tech Talk. I'm your host, Omar Shear. This season of Tech Talk, we will focus specifically on the internet.
A student would type their paper, and instead of handing me a hard copy of their paper, they would upload it to this learning system, okay. this e-learning system.
I have some great experience when it comes to technology, and in particular, internet technology. Call to action is something that we do in our day-to-day lives, and maybe we don't realize it. Now we want to discuss, after you have a product and you have a website and you have a way to communicate with your customers, which would be your email marketing system, now it's time to take the money from the customer.
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. Verse number 185 from Surat Al-Imran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ وَإِنَّمَا تُوَفَّوْنَ أُجُورَكُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فَمَنْ زُحْزِحَ عَنِ النَّارِ وَأُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةَ فَقَدْ فَازْ وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَاعُ الْغُرُورِ. Which means every soul will taste death, and you will only be given your full compensation on the day of resurrection. So he who is drawn away from the fire and admitted to paradise, to Jannah, has attained his desire. And what is the life of this world except the enjoyment of delusion? كل نفس ذائقة الموت. كل means every. And when the verse starts with every soul, that means exclusive. There is no exceptions. No creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will escape from this. This is something that is inevitable. Every single human being, they believe in this. And that's why it's a matter of belief, of course, and it's a fact of life. And it has its implications. That's always the way of the Quran. There's no statements mentioned like that for just an idea for a person to think of, or a fact of life, and that's it. Where is the effect of that in our speech and actions? That we would see clearly in the Quran. And that's what we need to. This is the benefit of pondering over the verses in the Quran. Kullu nafs. Nafs means soul. And it's nakira. It means every single soul. Any soul that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created. Dha'iqatul maut. Dha'iqa, which means will taste. Right? As we heard previously in the verse number 181. وَنَقُولُ ذُوقُوا ذُوقُوا. This is the order of taste, the punishment of the blazing fire. Here, ذَائِقَ, this is the pronoun of tasting. That every soul shall taste al-maut, death. That means death has a taste to it. And this is what the Quran says. And every single one of us will taste death, and it's very close to us. Before much before that, before what we think it is, closer to us, because usually the human being, they have long hope. As the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in the authentic hadith, that our hopes for the most of the time is so much extended beyond our lifespan. Our lifespan might end in a second, in a minute, and our hopes are extended always in years and years. And that's why we need to live according to this fact. How many people are dying now? How many people there passed away? Actually, when we look into those who are still alive, they are the minority compared to those who are under the ground, those who are buried since the time of Adam alayhi salam. Every generation comes, is given their chance. And our chance, now we are witnessing it. It's a great virtue, it's a great bounty. It's such a great bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we are still alive, not for us to eat and drink and to enjoy and that's it. The great bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we have the chance to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That we have the chance to be among the highest level of the people of Jannah. To have the chance to be among the best. Can we do this even at the time that we live in with the different temptations and sins and evenness and so on? Yes, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. But we need to make the matter so clear, and the matter for us to be patient and to be sincere. So knowing this is as a fact, that every soul shall taste death. And we're living at a time when death is something that we see all the time, becomes so easy. This is the nature of the times of fitna and tribulations. So how many of those who we know personally, and we lived with, or we interacted with, or had something to do with them, and they passed away? And how is it close to, very close to us? And one of the early generations of Islam, he said something that shows how they used to ponder over these things. Someone asked him to remind him, and to give him a good reminder, to make him work more and more for the sake of Allah, and to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He told him, so that he has a short hope, not a long hope in this life. He said, how many people in your lineage are present, are alive, between you and Adam alayhi salam? If you look at your lineage, your ancestors, till Adam alayhi salam, how many of those are still alive? You can say, my father. Some people might say, my father and my grandfather. Some people might say, my father, grandfather, my great-grandfather. This is so much, not too many people would say that. And almost this is it, right? For those who have the ability to understand and so on. Many, many of us, we don't even have our fathers passed away, right? And the reason why he asked him this question is because if there's not too many people from your ancestors between you and Adam alayhi salam, that means you're next. You're very close. You're very close to depart from this life. And even if a person is a child, how many people die when they're young? And it's not necessarily that a person, there's no such a guarantee that human beings, they have to live till they're 60, there's no retirement. And then after that, then death, they have the chance of them dying after that, there's no such a thing. And that's why it's at any time. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us the intellectual abilities to think and to make actions and to make decisions. If a person is told, while he or she are sitting in their own comfort of their homes, that if they are told that any minute your enemy will come and attack your home and take your life away, would you sit comfortably in your house, even though you do not know when they would come? Nobody would. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. We're not ordered to live in our life panicking. This is not the case, of course. But we need to live our life with the reality of things. The Prophet ﷺ said, أَكْثِرُوا ذِكْرَ هَذِي مِنْ لَذَّتِ. Remember death much, frequently. Why? Because we tend to forget. We tend to be in state of forgetfulness. And when a person is in state of forgetfulness, sins become so easy, enjoying the sins and the desires. But does that mean that we would live a life of misery if you always remember death? Of course not. If we remember death and as a result of that we will do what is obligations and stay away from what is haram and enjoy the things that Allah made it permissible for us. The deen of Al-Islam permits for us to be happy and to enjoy what is halal, and everything that you would find haram, you have many alternatives that is halal, and only that is wicked and evil is made prohibited for us. So if people would think this way, right, then they would have the real happiness of this life and in the hereafter. And what is the meaning of happiness and desire? If it leads to the hellfire, if it leads to our own destruction, there is no happiness then. It's all misery. So the real happiness is when a person is obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the message of the Quran. A person won't lose anything. A person would still live a goodly life. A person would enjoy things in his life, would still enjoy a good taste and good relationships and marriage and all kinds of things. But for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. So, kullu nafsin da'iqatul maut, every soul shall taste death. What is the implication? What is the outcome? Wa innama tuwaffawna ujurakum yawm al-qiyam. And indeed, verily, the exclusive term here, tuwaffawna ujurakum, you will be given ujurakum, your rewards, your compensations, you will be given that tuwaffawna in full. Nobody will be given less. Everybody will be given their full compensation, not in this life. يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. In the day of resurrection. This life is short. The day of resurrection is the day when people will get their compensation. The full justice will be served. So never panic, never be in a miserable state when you see the unjust or the corruption, whatever there is, prevails temporarily. Definitely it will be defeated, but maybe not in your generation. Maybe not in your life. Maybe you won't see it, because life is very short and death comes at any time. But for the believers, either they see something in their life, or if death comes, they return to the mercy of Allah. And they would never want to come back to this world anymore. And the full justice will be served in the Day of Judgment, and that's where the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the ultimate and the everlasting, the unimaginable mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be also served in the Day of Judgment for the believers. وَإِنَّمَا تُوَفَّوْنَ أُجُورَكُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. And also the implication of that, don't seek rewards in this life, seek the rewards in hereafter. This is a deed done by the heart. Has nothing to do with what happens on the face of earth. Our intentions is that we seek the rewards of our actions in the hereafter, not in this life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His mercy, promised the believers, if this is their attitude, that they will be given good things in this life. They will have a happy life, but this is not their intentions. And the significance of this, what if a person is faced with calamities? Would they leave the straight path? Would they be disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because they were obedient to Allah only for some worldly benefit? This is not religion. The religion is when a person is patient, hearts are attached to the hereafter. And once this is there, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give the goodly life also for the believers. وَإِنَّمَا تُوَفَّوْنَ أُجُورَكُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامِ Such a great statement that if we keep on repeating this over and over again and thinking of the implications and making decisions to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to live for what's coming ahead, because it's really not worth it to compromise and to waste the everlasting life for some temporary, very short life that we live on the face of earth. وَإِنَّمَا تُوَفَّوْنَ أُجُورَكُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فَمَنْ زُحْزِحَ عَنِ النَّارِ وَأُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةَ فَقَدْ فَازَ So for those who will be drawn away from the hellfire and admitted to Jannah has attained the ultimate joy. فَمَنْ refers to a human being, to those who will be responsible for their actions. فَمَنْ in the day of judgment, those فَمَنْ زُحْزِحَ عَنَّ those who are pushed away, those who are drawn away from the hellfire and enter Jannah, they are the successful ones. They are the ones that would attain their full desires. And see the Arabic, of course the Quran, miraculous in its statements, in its linguistics and so on. The word, and I would ask you, this is sometimes we do that once in a while, because you would have a certain feeling to it. See the word and feel what it means. Zuhzih. See, it's repeated. The letters are repeated. Zuhzih, right? Zuhzih means when a person is pushed, right? So you get the feel that the ultimate success is when a person is pushed away from the fire. That means the hellfire is very close. That means a person can fall into the hellfire. When you are being pushed away from something, that means you're there and you're pushed away from it. So this is how close the matter is. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Maryam, وَإِن مِّنكُمْ إِلَّا وَارِدُهَا that each and every one of you shall pass by the hellfire. We know that the Sirat is on top of the hellfire, underneath which is the hellfire, and the believers will cross. That means they are very close to the hellfire. Some of them would fall. Some of them would get effect of it, and some of them would pass very quickly, and we talked about that hadith many times before. And the other side is the Jannah. And the significance of this, that we are very close to the hellfire and we are very close to the Jannah. And this is why one of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that are very strong in targhib and tarheeb, in glad tidings and warning, very severe in both, is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, الْجَنَّةُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَىٰ أَحَدِكُمْ مِنْ شِرَاكِ نَعْلِ وَالنَّارُ مِثْلُ ذَلِكُ Which means the Jannah, paradise, is very close to one of you than his own shoelace, very close, like the shoes. And the hellfire is the same way. That means how close the matter is. It's not something that we think it's far away or it's as if it's a fairy tale. It's very, very close. Once the moment of death comes, the believers will get to see their place in Jannah. The disbelievers will get to see their place in the hellfire. So whoever pushed away from the hellfire and they are admitted into Jannah, فَقَدْ فَزْ This is al-fawz. This is the real success. This is the real winning. Then, and the real attainment of one's desire is in the hereafter. So that means we would see that those who would choose this world, they are really following foolishness, right? And then وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَاعُ الْغُرُورِ And what is this life of this world is nothing but enjoyment of delusion. Enjoyment of delusion. Delusion, why? Because it goes away. And what's everlasting is the hereafter. Does that mean that we abandon this life? Of course not. This is the path to the hereafter. And the deen of Islam, again, does not deprive you from your desires of this life, but to control it according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. And this is the success of this life and in the hereafter. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the proper understanding of the deen of Allah. And to give us the steadfastness to act according to what the verses of the Quran says, and to make it easy for us to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to value what Allah values, and to not to have the value of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does, makes us understand that where is the value? The value is in the hereafter. This dunya becomes so valuable if it's in the obedience of Allah, because it becomes no value if it's in the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and matters of disbelief. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the proper understanding, and we'll continue inshallah ta'ala towards the end of the surah of Ali Imran next time. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا.
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا.
فلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا.